Today, I would like to introduce myself to you first of all. My name is, I'm Ahmed Halim Ayoub, graduated from Alexandria University in 1994. I'm the president of the Egyptian Society of Oral Implantology. Can you hear me there? Or I have to use the mic.
Yes.
You can hear. Okay, very good. I'm the president of the Egyptian Society of Oral Implantology, ex-board member of International Group for Oral Rehabilitation in France, and present board member in London Oral Reconstructive Academy. I'm a fellow of Seville University, Spain, and visiting lecturer in Seville University and Almeria University in Spain. My practice, private practice, limited to dental implants only. It has been a long time. I didn't use a normal contra-angle and I didn't hold the endodontic file in my hand. I like always to work only implantology or laser. I like both actually. I like laser a lot, soft laser without tissue laser. And I'm a clinical advisor in Dux German Dental Academy, editor in International Journal of Oral Care and Research. Today I'm going to talk to you about a very nice subject, one of my favorite actually. I like this lecture, and I hope it will be interesting for you too. The title of the lecture is a fourth dimension concept in immediate implant placement. In general, what is a fourth dimension? We all know that we have three dimensions. Okay, you have width, you have height, and what is the third dimension?
Breadth.
Height, width, and depth. You have three dimensions. What I'm telling you, I will meet you somewhere. So in the third floor, you will come, we will meet in the third floor, apartment, blah, blah, blah. There is something missing, which is a fourth dimension. There is something missing. I can tell you, I will meet you there, third floor, right, you go right to this apartment, blah, blah, blah. But there is something missing, which is a fourth dimension. What is a fourth dimension? Fourth dimension is a time. The time is very important in our life. So when I tell you, I will meet you there, at what time? This is very important to know the timing. So the timing is important in our life and is important in dentistry also. So actually we have something called the fourth dimension. Today I'm going to talk to you about the fourth dimension in immediate implant placement. So now we are talking about two things, or we are going to talk about two things. First thing is the timing, the actual timing, or the right timing to do something. And second thing is the immediate implant placement. So let me first introduce to you the immediate implant placement. What is immediate implant placement? Immediate implant placement means that you are going to extract a tooth and place an implant immediately, same day. This is what we call an immediate implant placement. Why shall we do this? Why do you think I extract the tooth and place an implant? What is the main advantage of doing this?
The fourth dimension.
No, actually this is not the fourth dimension. Or maybe I can say you're right. But there is another main advantage. Why I shall remove a tooth and place an implant immediately? I would like you to tell me, what is the main advantage? Why don't you wait for 3 hours? Because the original Brelmar protocols said that you have to wait from 3 to 6 months for new bone formation and then you place your implant.
Maybe for bone resorption.
Preservation.
Exactly, exactly. You preserve the bone. There is a very nice here article published in 2012 said that after extraction, you will have about it's called evidence-based knowledge on the biology and treatment of extraction socket. What it says? It says that after extraction, you will have 3.8 millimeter of vertical, of horizontal bone resorption. 6 months after extraction, you will lose 3.8 millimeter of bone. You imagine it's a lot. And vertical dimension, you will lose 1.24 millimeter. It's a mean. It's not a value. It's a mean average. 1.24 millimeter within 6 months after tooth extraction, which means that placing an implant immediately after extraction may preserve the bone. It may preserve the bone. That's why we are doing an immediate implant placement. And this is the main advantage. Something else, if you are, I'd like to turn this off because it's making some noise. I don't know.
Wait.
I cannot see any. I want to turn because I hear a noise. Strange. Anyway, if you preserve bone, what else you are preserving?
Tissue.
If you stop bone loss, you will stop soft tissue recession, which is very important. Now dentistry or implant dentistry is called pink dentistry. Pink dentistry, which is the tissues. Now everyone is talking about soft tissue management, papillary regeneration technique, connective tissue graft to increase the keratinized mucosa. So now we are preserving our pink tissue, which is very important, which is very valuable for us. Another old study from, I think, 1989, very old one, but it says also after dental extraction, you may have a bone loss up to 60% in the first 2 to 3 years. So imagine, when you extract the tooth, you will have 60% of bone loss. You will lose 60% of the amount of bone which is present now if you don't place an implant or do something else. Because, of course, not every patient will be able to place an implant. This is very good. If every patient has money to place an implant after extraction, this would be wonderful. But of course, not all of them can afford to place an implant after extraction. So we can do either immediate placement or something we will call a socket preservation. Usually, you know, there is something called three-dimensional implant positioning. So ideal three-dimensional implant positioning, and I believe some of you has some knowledge about implantology, so I will change the slide and I will ask you. I will not tell you, I will ask you. How many millimeter you have to leave between the implant and the neighboring tooth? 1.5 millimeter, exactly. Because you don't have to be very close to the neighboring tooth. You will destroy the bone architecture and you will press on the periodontal fiber, which will cause severe pain in the surrounding teeth. So 1.5 millimeter medial to the implant and 1.5 millimeter distal to the implant. Okay. What about buccolingual? How many millimeter of sound bone you need to leave buccal and palatal or lingual to the implant? It's one or the same? One or 1.5? What do you think?
Yeah, I prefer 1.5.
You prefer 1.5. So someone else would like to say something?
Someone say range.
Range.
Yeah.
Maybe this is better. So, what is the range?
I read before one article said that from 0.5 you can to 1.5 and 2 millimeters also.
So now we have another answer from 0.5 to?
1.5 and 2 millimeters.
1.5 and 2 millimeters.
Yeah.
Okay, so you have a wide range here.
Yeah.
You are in the safe side. So if I say 2, you have, it's okay. One is
like this. Yeah.
Any other answer? I will tell you. The ideal spacing or the ideal amount of bone that you have to leave palatal or lingual is 1 millimeter. It's fixed. But what about buccal or labial? And buccal here different than labial. Labial means upper anterior. Upper anterior, what is important of upper anterior area? It's an point zone. It's an aesthetic zone. So you need to leave 2 millimeters of sound bone buccal to the implant or labial to the implant. In the upper anterior, you need to leave 2 millimeters. Buccally, everywhere or anywhere, just 1 millimeter is enough. So this is what we call first dimension, second dimension, mesiodistal, buccolingual, and the apical incisor. Nowadays, you have to place all your implants below the crest of the ridge because of the platform switch. But usually, for the immediate implant placement, you have to place your implant at least 2 millimeters below the crest of the ridge. My hand is the crest of the ridge, as a pointer is the implant. It has to go 2 millimeters below the crest of the ridge. Why? Why shall I place my implant so deep?
Emergence
profile. Yes, this will be good for emergence profile. Emergence profile, this is a big word. Under emergence profile, there is a lot of things. But yes. But I need simpler explanation.
But you do it upper or lower?
Whatever. You have to go 2 to 3 millimeters below the crest of the ridge.
Why?
Bone loss. After extraction, whenever you are very careful in your extraction, you will have a bone resorption or bone loss. You will no way not to have a bone resorption after extraction. So you need to place your implant on the level of the future bone. So 2 millimeter or 3 or more depends on, shall I go 2 millimeter, 1 millimeter below the crest, 2 millimeter, 3 millimeter, 4 millimeter below the crest of the ridge, depends on what?
Thickness
of the Barker plate of bone, very good, very good. Thickness of the Barker plate of bone. If you have a thick Barker plate of bone, so you will have less resorption. So you only can go 1 or 2 millimeter below this Barker plate of bone. If you have a thin Barker plate of bone and a lot of defects, so you will have to go 3 to 4 millimeters below the crest of the ridge. This is what we call the ideal three-dimensional implant positioning. However, are these existing factors enough to perform and or to get an optimal outcome? No. We need the fourth dimension. Fourth dimension, as I told you, is a timing. Fourth dimension means timing. What is the timing in the immediate implant placement? It means simply to place the implant or not to place the implant. To make an immediate implant placement or to make a delayed implant placement. So to know about the timing, we have to know, I was telling you here, is to place or not to place, that is the question. So first of all, we need to know the time of extraction and implant placement. So you have three options. Either you extract, and we call it immediate implant placement into extraction socket, you extract and your extraction socket and you find that you have a defect, buccal bone defect or whatever, here you have to open a flap. So first of all, you have an immediate implant placement into extraction socket immediately. Second option, it's called early implant placement, which means that you extract the tooth and you place your implant later on, after from 1.5 to 2 months. But during those 8 to 12 weeks, you may have a bone resorption. So you have to stop the bone resorption. After extraction, you cannot place your implant. You will wait. The patient cannot afford placing an implant now. So you will do something else. We will talk about it just after a while. Number three is the timing, is delayed implant placement, which means that you will wait for 6 months until you have enough bone, and then you place your implant, which is the original Brennemark protocol. Long time ago, Brennemark said this. But as I told you, if you'd like to make an early implant placement or delayed implant placement, you may end up with a lot of bone resorption, especially the worst resorption pattern is in the anterior maxilla. The worst resorption pattern. You have a severe horizontal resorption immediately after extraction, and I will tell you why. Why, especially in this area, you have a severe horizontal resorption. So you can extract the tooth. The patient cannot afford to place an implant now. What shall I do? I cannot leave the socket like this. First of all, stop, please, please stop squeezing your sockets. After extraction, you don't have to squeeze the socket. Do not squeeze anymore in your live sockets. It's enough, you destroyed a lot of bone before. You squeezed a lot of bone. So please stop squeezing the extraction socket. Even if you do not squeeze, you will have bone resorption. So what can we do to stop or to reduce the bone resorption? Do you know?
Socket preservation.
Socket preservation. There is a very nice concept called socket preservation. Actually, if you extract the tooth, as you can see here, what will happen in the extraction socket? You will have a blood clot, and then when the extraction socket will be filled with blood clot and granulation tissues, then you will have a provisional matrix, and the woven bone will start to remodel. And then, second stage, this very thin buccal plate of bone called bundle bone. It will start to resorb. The bundle bone here will resorb very quickly. And after a few slides, I will tell you why it will resorb. So it will resorb very quickly, and you will have a reduction in the horizontal dimension. But if you extract and put some bone graft here, you will interfere with this second stage, which has a bundle bone resorption. and you will have a very nice width of the ridge. Later on, you can place your implant. Like here, you extract, put some bone graft, and wait, you will have a nice result. You can later on place your implant. Even if you don't place your implant, if you have a severe, after extraction, you have a severe vertical and horizontal bone loss, your fixed restoration will be very bad. Even if you are not going to place your implant, you will have a lot of dimension changes in the bone, and you will have a non-hygienic fixed restoration. The patient will not be able to clean it easily. So it's better always extract and put few bone grafts, few particles of bone graft to preserve the bone. Still, we are asking, when shall we go for immediate implant placement, and when shall we go to delayed implant placement? Because I'm talking till now about immediate implant placement, socket preservation. Okay, here is the fourth dimension, the timing. When do you think you have to go for immediate implant placement, and when do you think you have to go for socket preservation and delayed implant placement? We have two considerations. You have to ask yourself about two things, two considerations, and according to those two considerations, you will decide, you will take a decision. Am I going to place my implant immediately or delayed? Let me show you the two considerations. First consideration is, so we have two considerations. First one is, does implant retain buccal wall really? We have to ask ourselves, if I place my implant immediately, will it retain the buccal plate of bone? Am I going to stop the buccal plate of bone resorption really? We will see. Second consideration, does the presence of infection will compromise immediately placed implant success? Why do you extract the tooth? Usually, you extract the tooth for a lot of reasons. Most of extractions due to infection, failed endodontic treatment, whatever, any kind of extraction. Most of them, if you think, today I extracted 10 teeth. Why? 8 of them because of infection. 7 of them because of infection. Can I place an implant immediately while I have an infection in the extraction socket? We will answer this question. So first of all, let's check about the first consideration, which is, does implant retain the buccal plate of bone or not? In a lot of researches and articles following immediate implant placement, they found that They were studying in 98, 2003, 2009, 2008, 2009. They were studying the buccal recession or buccal gingival recession after immediate buccal mucosa recession after immediate implant placement. If you have a soft tissue recession, this means that you have a bone also resorption. What they found? They found that you can expect about 1 millimeter of recession of buccal gingiva after immediate implant placement, which means you can make an immediate implant placement, and after all, you will have also more resorption. But not in all types of bone. Let me be more specific and tell you about the bundle bone, which is very important bone. Why we will have some more resorption? I will tell you. We have, when you extract a teeth or a tooth, you have a very thin buccal plate of bone, as you can see here. You see, this is the buccal or labial plate of bone. Usually, this is present in the upper anterior teeth. Here is the labial plate of bone. What is this labial plate of bone? It's called the bundle bone. When it is very thin like this, it is called the bundle bone. The embryonic origin of this bundle bone is coming from the tooth bud. He's a sister, or he's a brother of the tooth. The blood supply, the feeding of this bundle bone is coming from the periodontium, not from the periosteum. So when you extract the tooth, what will happen to this poor bundle bone? He will lose his sister. He will extract the tooth, and he will lose the periodontium. So after extraction, let me show you what will happen. Look here. You will lose the buccal plate of bone, which is the bundle bone. That's why you have to do something different to maintain this buccal plate of bone or this bundle bone, and I will tell you how to do it, how to maintain it, how to keep it. So you have to make an immediate implant placement plus some other procedures to keep this vodka little more bondable. So we are talking about implant retain. Does implant really retain buccal bone? In a collection of articles, they said that all studies show vertical and horizontal bone loss 6 months after implant placement. So even after implant placement or after immediate implant, you may have bone resorption. And you may have a horizontal reach change from 1.05 to 6.8. I think 6.8 is really exaggerated. 1.05 is the right or actual amount of resorption. So here you will have 1.05 resorption while you make immediate implant placement. But remember, in my second slide, I told you if you extract the tooth and wait for 6 months, how many millimeters will resort? 3.68, I think. If you don't make an immediate implant placement, you will lose 3.68 millimeter of bone. If you make an immediate implant placement, you may lose 1 millimeter. Okay, so this is better. And you will have a vertical bone resorption from 0.2 to 1 millimeter. So obviously, implants do not retain thin buccal bone, and you see here, thin. If you have a thick buccal bone, the implant will retain it. But if you have a thin buccal bone, you have to do something different to keep it. What can we do? Let me show you.
Graft.
You have to graft. You have to create space to put some bone graft. You have to place your implant palatal, as you can see. You have to, you drill palatal. And you put your implant palatal and then graft here. You have to put some bone graft. Never get your primary stability in immediate implant placement from the surrounding bone, from the buccal, from mesial, from distal, because if you take a wide implant to get your primary stability from your wets, so you press on the bone here, you will press on the periodontal fibers of the neighboring teeth. The only way to get a good primary stability in immediate implant placement is to get it from the apical portion. You have to drill a little bit in the sound bone to get your primary stability. So first of all, you can place your implant palatal, as you can see here. You drill palatal. You have to drill. Look at this. Oh, I don't have the picture here. So you have to drill palatal and place your implant palatal. And then fill this gap. This is what we call the jumping gap. You have to fill this jumping gap with a lot of bone graft particles. And also don't leave this extraction socket empty, especially in the anterior region, because the bone will collapse and you will have bad aesthetics. So you have to fill all with bone graft. Take care while using bone graft or filling an extraction socket with a bone graft, because you have two different things. Or we may think that it's two opposite things. I will tell you two opposite things, but actually it's not opposite. First of all, when you put some bone graft, you have to push your bone graft till the apex of the socket. Don't take just a few particles of bone graft, put it, I put a bone graft. No, it's not like this. You have to push it till the apex of the socket. But you don't have to condense it. I told you it's two opposite. How I push it and not to condense, because it's not good to have a condensation of bone particles, bone graft particles. You know why? Why I don't want it to be condensed? Because
space.
To be space for plastic. Yes. You need space. You know, according to Dennis Tarnow, he said that if you condense your bone graft, you will delay the healing in new cells. So you just push your bone graft to the apical area, but do not condense. It's not an amalgam. It's a bone graft, so you do not have to condense it. Something very important in the upper anterior, the upper premolar, always the extraction socket is oval. You see here the extraction socket is oval in shape. So you will choose a narrow implant according to the mesiodistal dimension, and again you need to have some bone graft in your clinic to fill the buccal and palatal gap. What about the molar or the multi-rooted teeth? We have a very important rule, a biomechanical rule, that if you follow it, you will keep your implant for a long time. You will have no biomechanical problem. You will have no fracture in the screw, no loosening in the screw, no implant fracture. which is in the posterior region, you have to place your implant below the mesial root, below the distal root, below the central fossa. Choose one of the three answers. In the posterior region, you have to place your implant, number one, below the mesial root, number two, below the distal root, number three, below the central fossa. Below the central fossa, you have, it's a must that you place your implant below the central fossa, because any other position, you will have a lot of problems, bone resorption, screw loosening, implant fracture, screw fracture, a lot of biomechanical problems. So always you have to place your implant, as you see here, in the central fossa. You have to break the interradicular bone. Can break it and place your implant here. And again, I remind you that you get your primary stability from this area. You drill here, you make some drilling and get your primary stability from the sound bone below the crest of the ridge. Again, to this study, who was talking about the bundle bone, it's published in 2012, and they were talking about also, if you don't put a bone in the buccal plate of bone, in the jumping gap between the implant and the buccal plate of bone, you will end up by bone resorption. Or if you place your implant a little bit properly, you will end up by bone resorption. But if you place your implant palatally, as I told you, and you put some bone graft here, you will have a very nice, you will stop the remodeling process. The remodeling process means abundant bone resorption. You will stop it and you will have a very nice bone. Let me show you one of my cases, but usually, I want to tell you something. When someone goes to a congress, he chooses best cases. And he showed to you, when you see those cases, this is wonderful. You start to do the same technique, you do not get the results like this guy. Why? Because this guy is showing you 20% of his cases. He chooses every one of us, everyone, whatever his very good experience, though he's not experienced, he's doing bad things. And he doesn't have the very nice result at the end. In everyone from 10 cases can only get you a very good two cases to show in the congresses. Ah, wow, this is nice, look at the soft tissue texture. So don't think that everyone is coming to show you a lecture, he's getting a very good work. Because previously, I used to see very nice pictures, soft tissue, nice teeth. Oh my God, I cannot achieve these results. Why? I'm bad. No, I'm not bad. He's coming to show you the best. But I'm trying to show you my worst cases because I want you to learn from my mistakes. This is always my strategy in my courses. I show my bad things, my mistakes, because I don't want to show you my good things. I want you to learn from my mistakes. Let me show you one of my bad cases. It's an old case. This patient had a bone resorption here, as you can see. You can never place an implant in periodontally affected patient. You will have to wait, or to send, not to wait, sorry. You have to send it to periodontist. He will manage the case and send it back to you. Because deep pocket is a source of infection for the implant. So this preoperative x-ray, after periodontal management, I extracted those teeth. Of course, when a patient comes to you like this, you have to tell her, after I place my implants and teeth, you will not become Julia Roberts. You came like this. Don't expect that you came like this. So I will improve a little bit, but you are not Sophia, you are not Julia Roberts after. So after extraction, and before you start your drilling, you have to do something in the extraction socket. You need to have a very good cullet. Why? What are you going to remove from inside the extraction socket? Infection, chronic lesion, you have some granulation tissues, and granulation tissues.
We want to make motivation for circulation.
Motivation, yes. And something.
You remove the periosteum?
not periosin. Periosin is not inside the extraction socket. But what you have inside the extraction socket, you need to clean
bacteria.
Periodontal fibers. Yes, yes. I know when you said periosin, you mean, I know, I'm sure. So always you need to have a very sharp curette in your clinic. And you need to make a very good curettage. Here is a very nice tool called bone expansion, bone expander, sorry, or bone spreaders or whatever. It is very nice, it's a soft bone. Anyway, maybe one day I can explain to you more about the bone expansion. Instead of drilling, I use bone expansion. And I placed four implants. One, this is number one, and this is number two, number three, number four. Someone will tell me number whatever has the whatever mistake. Again, I'm telling you, number one, number two, number three, number four.
Number two.
Yes, what is wrong with number two?
Buckle.
Yes, okay. I didn't see it. Actually, I'm telling you the truth. I didn't see it while doing the surgery. Because, unfortunately, sometimes I'm interested in taking pictures more than doing the surgery. Because I have to take pictures for my lecture. The patient called me a few days after the surgery. She told me, "Doctor, I have a color of metal below the gingiva." This case, a very old case from 2003 or 2004. In 2003 and 2004, our main concern was osseointegration, only this. We didn't realize that there is something called nice aesthetics, blah, blah, blah. No, only osseointegration. So I asked her, implant is still there? She told me, yes. Okay, very good, forget about it. She came back to me after several months. I saw the implant. Now I can see implant below the mucosa, the implant. So I thought when I take out the cover screw, the implant will comes out with me. Unscrew the cover screw. Implant is still there. Okay, I'll put my healing abutment. The implant will fall down, of course. Screwing the healing abutment. So I screwed my healing abutment, the implant doesn't move. How come the implant, I see the implant below the gingiva, but it doesn't move. So I had to open the flap to see, and let me show you what I've seen. The buckle replaced, labial replaced implant caused a very slow resorption for the labial plate of bone, and at the same time, I had an osseointegration all around. You see here, we have osseointegration. And here also a very small piece of labial plate of bone did not resorb. We have bone resorption and osseointegration at the same time. Actually, 2003-2004, and I started my implant work in 98. Just back to the past and think about something. We didn't have something called internet. 98. No knowledge. Our dear professors didn't want to teach us implantology. Because I don't know if here is the same or not. For example, in orthodontic treatment in Egypt, it's a mafia. So they didn't teach us orthodontic treatment because it's only a few doctors doing this, very expensive, and they don't want any competitors. So our dear professors in Egypt didn't want to teach us implantology. And you know, if you need here a book, now for now, you go for Google, blah, 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 .pdf, you will have the book for free. But we didn't have Google. We didn't have internet. So it was very difficult to learn. I've learned by my mistakes, trials and errors. So at this time, I thought that if I put some bone graft here, I will have new bone. But let me tell you a golden rule about the bone graft. The bone graft will not become bone. I thought this long time ago. I put some powder, it will become bone. No, the bone graft will not become bone. It will enhance bone formation in an area that would have bone in any way. If you put bone graft or not, it would have bone. If you have an implant like this, going out of the buccal plate of bone, here is the labial plate of bone, of the buccal plate of bone, and my implant is out. Don't think that you will put some bone graft here and you will have bone. No, you will never have bone. I thought I would have bone. When you will have bone, when the implant is below, okay, my hand is the implant, it's below the level of the labial bit of bone, here you can put some bone graft and you will have wonderful results. But here, no. I put bone graft, I didn't know, I told you. Learning early time was only by trials and errors. So I put some bone graft and a membrane sutures. Look at here. I cannot see the shadow of the implant. I said, oh my God, I had a lot of bone. No, it was not bone. It was soft tissue or fibrous tissue encapsulation of the bone graft. But I was happy because I didn't see the shadow of the implant. Yes, I'm not going to see it because I have a lot of soft tissue now, but this is not bone. At the end, with bone or without bone, the position of the implant is very bad. This is what we call a positional failure. This is what we call a positional failure. One of the most common failures is a positional failure when you place your implant labially and recession and a lot of problems. My prosto decided, he told me, because I hate prosthesis, I have someone doing this for me. He told me, we are not going to use this one. We will make our surgery over, our prosthesis over those three implants. So actually the final result, not very good and not very bad, but I always show the patient her picture before. You always need to have a picture pre and post operative. So if the patient tell you, what is this? And you know, look how you came to me. Look now, what you look like. So it wasn't bad. Here is the pre and here is the post. I wanted just to show you my mistake. Take care of this because it's very common mistake. I have a very nice lecture about the complications and one of them are our failures. And one of the most failures is a positional failure. And the most common positional failure is this. Labial placing the implant. Usually this happens because you want to place your implant like this. So you put the neck of the implant very labial. No, I have to go back. Take care of this. So back to our considerations. We said, or we talked about the first consideration, which is, does implant retain buckled bit of bone? Really, is the implant retain buckled bit of bone? Now we know. If you have thin buckled bit of bone, place your implant palatal, put some nice bone graft, do not condense the bone graft, push your bone graft to the apex of the socket, and that's it. You will have no resorption. So here is the first consideration, and you can choose, and actually you can choose immediate placement or delayed placement or socket grafting according to your skills. If you have good skills in implantology, go for immediate placement. If your skills, if you are just beginner, you are starting your first steps, it's better always to go for socket preservation. Now we will talk about second consideration, which is, does the presence, let me show you, second, does the presence of infection compromise? Does the presence of infection compromise immediately placed implant success? As I told you, most of your extraction due to either fracture or infection. So, if you have an infection and you place your implant, can you place an implant in infection or not? We will answer this question. I will answer you through some articles, a recent one. Someone said in 2010, always you will find in red my source, the source from where I'm getting what I'm saying to you. The article called Fresh Socket Implants in Periapical Infected Sites in Humans. And the conclusion, he said that it rendered an equally favorable soft and hard tissue integration of the implant, revealing a predictable outcome. Which means, according to this study, if you have an infection, you can place an implant. This is controversial a little bit. Let me show you another study and we discuss it together. Another one in 2012, in April 2012, it said that, or the name was immediate implant placement in infected sites, a case series. And it said, it may be a valid operative technique which leads to predictable results if adequate pre- and post-operative care is taken.
you have a pass, you can please fill in. No way.
Those people are not talking about acute infection, because we have to know that we have two types of infection. We have to differentiate between acute infection, when you can see pus coming out, and chronic lesion. Chronic lesion. With a chronic lesion, you can place your implant. You will do a very good curettage with a sharp curette. You will do a very good curettage, take out this, all these tissues, and put your implant or put some bone graft. But when you see pus, you can never place implant or bone graft. What you can do? Irrigation, curettage, antibiotic treatment for 10 days, and the patient comes back to you after 10 days to place his implant or whatever to put your bone graft.
What do you mean by pus? To see the inside or outside?
In the socket. In the socket.
Pus is still in the socket?
Yes.
Okay, remove the tooth.
Huh?
Remove the tooth.
You remove the tooth, but you have the source of infection is still there.
Yeah, don't place implant.
Yes, you remove it. You will take out the tooth.
Yeah.
You will make a very good curettage. Antibiotic, and with 10 days, and then continue your treatment. You cannot make an immediate implant placement today when you have a pus.
Yeah, sure.
But if you have a chronic lesion, it's okay. A very recent article talking about the presence, if you have a cyst, look, this one is from 2015. If you have a cyst, what can you do? Can you make an immediate implant placement? They said something nice, it's Chinese surgeons. Immediate placement of teeth, implants for replacement of teeth with pre-existing infected cyst is a predictable treatment. So, okay, with a cyst also you can make an immediate implant placement and can be indicated for replacing tooth lost due to the pre-existing infected site. You can, the infected cyst. So you can do it. You can. With a cyst, you can make an immediate implant placement. With a chronic lesion, you can make an immediate replacement. But with an acute infection, you cannot make an immediate replacement. Excuse me, I will drink some water. And continue with
Mr. Boz.
Thank you. Okay, we said now, if you have a chronic lesion, there is no problem. You can go for immediate placement. But take care, because you still have some problems with an infected socket. And here I'm talking about chronic. Okay, we said acute infection, you will not do anything. Still, you may have some problems with a chronic infected socket. What is the problems you may face? First of all, when you make a curettage, are you sure that you took out all the infected materials? Are you sure? You will never be sure. No one will be sure. So, you don't know. Number two, primary sterility will be a big question here, because look at this. We have a cyst here and a lot of bone resorption. Bone resorption, you are supposed to get your primary sterility from this bone. This bone resorbed. Let me show you this case. It was a very nice case. Look at the cyst here. So I had to clean everything, extract the remaining of the tooth. And here you have two choices. Either immediate implant placement or socket preservation. And telling you the truth, the ideal here is not what I've done. The ideal was just to place implant, put bone graft. Wait for 6 months, for 7 months. You will open later on. You will have a very nice bone. You place your implant in a very nice way. But I choose to do it the hard way. Sometimes, because I do, this is my work, to do lectures. So a lot of times I bring patients for free. I do all of this work for free just to take stupid pictures. So I have to choose the difficult way to show it to you later on. So here I choose it. I choose to place an implant immediately. From where can I get my primary sterility? I have to take a very long implant to get primary sterility from this area. I place my implant, and again I'm telling you, never touch this remaining bucket bit of bone. Go palatal. You see, I never touch this, and I use a huge amount of bone graft. Show you. We use a huge amount of bone graft here, and see here, we have a very nice bond after 6 months. I can see we have a side discussion, so you can tell me if you have a question.
No.
I know, is this case is a controversial, really?
He's asking about flapless England.
I love flapless England treatment. This is my favorite. I rarely open flap, but here you have to open.
It depends on the case.
Depends on it. But I'm a big fan of flapless. I love it. When you choose to make an immediate implant placement, you need to have a lot of skills, because usually you will face some problems. Like this case, I'll show you one. It's an old case, but I love it, because I did something different here. I had a fracture in the crown, as you can see. So, and let us take a look on the preoperative situation here, this one. The tooth is a little bit labial outside the curvature of the arch, and we have a bulgy labial bit of extracting the tooth, of course, reveal a very small socket. Usually, the ideal decision here is socket preservation. Why? Why is the ideal decision is socket preservation, not immediate placement? What is the problem if I place an implant in this extraction socket?
The position
of the socket is labial, and again I will have the same problem of bone labial bone resorption. And the position of the tooth will not be nice. It will be again outside the arch. So the best thing to do here is simply to put some bone graft and wait. But the hard way to do it is to use the expansion. I told you the expansion technique to expand this bone.
Go palatal.
Go palatal. Yes, exactly. I go palatal, I place my implant here with the same curvature of the arch, and here you have to squeeze this protruded bone, squeeze it, break it, because you don't need any more protruded bone, squeeze it, and let me show you the pre- and post-operative situation. Here we have the pre-operative situation and the final situation. You have no protruded bone because you broke it, and the tooth is with the arch. On the same arch with the surrounding teeth. Another situation for immediate implant placement, when you have a fracture in the root, endodontically treated tooth, and we have a root fracture, you will find also, you will have bone resorption till the level of fracture. This will always happen. When you have a fracture, you will have bone resorption till the level of the fracture. Extracting the remaining root will reveal a bone defect. If you have bone defect, according to Henry and Maurice Salema, if you have bone defect less than 4 mm of the buccal plate of bone, you can go for immediate implant placement. If this buccal bone defect more than 4 mm, it's better to go for socket preservation. So it was. And the nice thing here, I could place my implant not at the level of the labial plate of bone or more or outside the labial plate of bone. No, it's inside the buccal plate, not labial. It's inside the buccal plate of bone, so I have a gap here, so it's safe to put some bone graft. You have a very nice bone. I put some bone graft and a membrane, and I have a nice bone, which I will show you. I had nice bone at the end. Another nice case, or nice situation actually, and a case that took a lot of work from me and my teamwork. When a patient comes like this, the patients now are aware and they always think about the aesthetics. There is something called the aesthetic demand of the patient. What is the aesthetic demand of the patient? It means this patient thinks about aesthetics or he doesn't care about aesthetics. What do you think about this patient? Do you think about aesthetics or he doesn't care? He doesn't care, of course. Look at the bridge, the restoration is very bad. Look at the finish line, look at here, and look at here. All of this is fixed restorations. And he had fracture in the post, ready-made post. It always happened. This fracture is a ready-made post. It always happened. So, first of all, I was so happy because this patient doesn't think about his aesthetics. When you see an upper central or upper lateral teeth, tooth that needs implant to be replaced by implant, you have to think several times before accepting the case. First of all, you have to think about the aesthetic demand. Number two, you know about the gingival bile type, the thin and thick gingival bile type? You know what is thin and thick gingival bile type? Let me show you. This is a thin gingival bile type, and this one is a thick gingival bile type. What we can see here, when you have a thin gingival bile type, you will have a very thin buccal plate of bone, or labial bone. You will have a very thin soft tissue, and always you need a lot of soft tissue to create, to manipulate the soft tissue and create a thick band of keratinized mucosa around your restoration, which is called the emergence profile. So in thin gingival bile type, it's very difficult because you don't have tissues. But in thick gingival bile type, you have a lot of tissues, so this will be easy. In our case, it was a thin gingival bile type. How can you know this case is thin gingival or a thick gingival bile type? How I know from this picture that this is a thin gingival bile type?
You mean keratin?
The keratin. The keratin and something very easy. There's something very easy.
The color.
When you have pinkish white color, or almost it's becoming white color, so this is a thin gingival bile type because it reflects the white color of the bone. When it's red, it's a thick gingival bile type because you cannot see the white color of the bone. Very simple, without probe, without anything. So when we take out the broken part and we take a look, think about it. We have three challenges. First challenge, how to extract the remaining root without damaging the very thin buccal plate of bone.
Put file and...
Yes, this is a very good idea, really.
Always assume it.
Yes, really, this is a very, you can use a wide file, a big file, 45, 50. Yes, this is a very good idea, but not always working. But
yes, sure.
It is a very good idea.
And there is post inside here, in this case.
Okay. But don't forget that we have a broken post inside. As you said, yes, you just said.
In this case, we cannot
do it. So, we cannot do it. So, first challenge, how to extract this remaining root. Second challenge, how to increase the thickness of the labial plate of bone. Third challenge, how to increase the thickness of soft tissue. So, now you need to extract without damaging the bone. You need to increase the thickness of the labial plate of bone. You need to increase the thickness of mucosa. How to do it? Let me show you. Here is again the slide of thin and thick gingival bile type. First challenge is extraction. There is a very nice tool called periotome. Periotome is like the periodontal, it's like the one used for extraction, it's called
the elevator.
It's similar but very thin. It cuts the periodontal fibers from around the tooth so you can take it out very easy. Periotome, it's called periotome. Periotome is a wonderful instrument, but mostly when I buy periotome, I pay a lot of money and it's useless because very rare to find a good periotome. I had a good one. So as you can see, I inserted here to cut the periodontal fibers and the extraction was very easy. And it's not always like this. Not always that easy. Sometimes you use a periotome and you still need to use your extraction forces. So I take out very easy, as you can see, and the extraction was totally atraumatic. But here, the extraction was atraumatic, but I need to be traumatic. Why? I need to initiate healing. Healing is blood. We're a dentist. We love to see blood. We love to see bone, fractured bone. Blood, because blood is healing. We are like Dracula. Dracula say blood is life. And we say blood is healing. So I need to be traumatic and initiate some bleeding from here to get more healing from for the soft tissue. And as I used to do, I place my implant palatal. Drilling palatal. You see here? Drilling palatal direction. And then placing the implant palatal. I have here a jumping gap. What I'm going to do? What I have to do? Bone graft. And push, again, push my bone graft apically. You see, I'm pushing my bone graft apically without condensation. Then I take sutures and take care. You do not have to squeeze the papilla. Never squeeze the papilla with the sutures. So taking sutures without squeezing the papilla. Now, first challenge, done, extraction. Second challenge, which is increasing thickness of buccal lipid. Yes, it's okay. I place my implant palatal gap, put some bone graft, you will have bone. Done. Number three, how to get a lot of soft tissue from here. It's a very thin gingival white eye. I need to get soft tissue. So the patient demand was, is to, the patient asked me to make an immediate loading. You can see here the temporary crown.
In this case, immediate loading in this case?
Yes. He asked for immediate loading. I would prefer to do it delayed loading. You know why? Because with delayed loading, you will have soft tissue closure. Okay. So you will have a lot of soft tissue. Very nice. I can manage it and I create papilla, so on. But he asked for immediate loading. Okay. So I have to manage to make an immediate loading and to get a lot of soft tissue. How to do it? If you take a look at this temporary crown, you will notice something unusual, which is the neck of the crown is very thin, not like the upper, not like a normal upper central incisor. Very thin. Why? When you have a thin neck, you will have more soft tissue. Wide neck, you will have less soft tissue, because soft tissue will grow till it finds something to stop it. So, okay, you need an immediate implant, immediate loading, I will do it for you. But I will do a narrow neck. You don't tell him, of course, because if you tell him he will do narrow neck, you look at the neck. I don't plug this up. No, you don't tell him. You say it to yourself. I will do a narrow neck for the temporary restoration. And here, after the surgery, several weeks when I took out the sutures. And let's see the results after 6 months. Now, we have a very nice buccal plate of bone thickness, more thickness of buccal plate of bone. We have a very nice, this is what we call an emergence profile. You have a lot of soft tissue creating a nice emergence profile. And here is the final result of the patient. Of course, I don't like this, but I know the patient has no good, has no aesthetic demands. And it was actually like a war or a big fight to preserve the labial bit of bone. It is very difficult to preserve this thin buccal bit of bone. So we have done, me and my teamwork, we have done a lot of work to preserve this very thin buccal bit of bone. Finally, after the clinical cases, we will reach to recommendations and conclusion, because now has been a very long lecture. So I will go for recommendations. What do I mean by recommendations? When do you have to make an immediate implant placement? When do you have to make an immediate implant placement? When you have a patient with low lip line, look at this patient, low lip line, nice smile. So whenever, even if you do a pink porcelain, he doesn't care. Low lip line. So this one is indicated for immediate implant placement. You have no problem. If you make a big problem, doesn't care for you. So this is number one, low lip line. Number two, when you have a thick gingival morphology. Thick gingival morphology is very nice. You have a lot of soft tissue. Can manipulate, take suture here. Soft tissue, you can do a lot of things, soft tissue management, palliative technique, whatever. I invented a very nice technique for regeneration of the papilla when you have a thick gingival white eye. Number three is the immediate recommendation. When you have an intact buccal plate of bone, this is wrong. When you have a big defect, you don't have to go for immediate implant placement. Preserve your socket and then place an implant later on. Number four, maintain jumping gap at least 2 millimeters in the upper anterior region. Put your implant palatal and fill the gap as deep as possible. You see, I'm telling you again and again and again. Fill the gap as deep as possible, but do not condense your bone. Of course, you need also a good primary stability for the implant. Again, we are still talking about the immediate implant placement recommendation. Place the implant more palatal and deeper. Use narrow diameter implants so you can go palatal. You have a buccal defect, you place some bone graft. And of course, if you have a thick buccal plate of bone, this is a recommendation for immediate implant. What about the recommendation for delayed implant placement?
But before we jump, most of the cases shows only the upper anterior region.
Yes, this is a big
How
problem.
About the lower anterior?
You have no problem in lower anterior premolars because, or molars.
Anterior.
Anterior. You have no problem with you and look. for what is veneer. If you have patient coming for veneer, you will go for YouTube and for Google Images and check what is veneer. That's why I have a marketing lecture and I tell them, if you'd like to make a brochure, don't take pictures from Google Images, because okay, I want to put veneers, very good,